On the first Sunday of Christmas, we hear the profound words of the Gospel of John's opening poem. And the Word became flesh and lived among us. And we have seen his glory, the glory as of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. This simple message declares that God is revealed in a human person. Though we may try to understand how the Word existed with God from the beginning of time, the wonder we celebrate at Christmas is that the Word continues to dwell among us. Christ comes among us in the gathered assembly, the scriptures, the waters of new birth, and the bread and the wine. Through these ordinary gifts, we receive the fullness of God's grace and truth.
Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also
with you. O God, who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy, with humble spirits in the quiet of your presence, we welcome the gift of the new year.
We lift up our hearts to you, O Lord.
From the failures of the past, from broken hopes and disappointed ambitions, from our sins against ourselves and against others, from the transiency and vicissitude of our lives.
We lift up our hearts to you, O Lord.
We confess our unworthy living that has stained the record of the year that has passed, for pardon, for grace to make restitution, for a clean heart and a right spirit with which to enter the new year.
We lift up our hearts to you, O Lord.
Grant us honesty to face ourselves in the light of your grace. Save us from self-deceit, foolish excuses, and fear-filled evasions, and prepare us with inner integrity and spiritual resource that we may walk in faith before you.
Lord, deliver us.
From loss of faith and hope and courage, from anxiety that harasses us, fear that paralyzes us, cowardice that defeats us, and from the loss of your companionship, without which no life is good and no soul is strong.
Good Lord, deliver us.
From cherishing ill will in a world that perishes for want of goodwill, from selfishness in a world whose need of generosity and magnanimity is deep and desperate, from so living that Christ shall be crucified again and the kingdom of God delay its coming.
Good Lord, deliver us.
Confirm now in each of us some worthy decision. Bring us to the new year's beginning with such vision of our duty, such resolution to perform it, and such resources for its consummation that, whether in the year ahead we live or fall asleep, we shall be neither dishonored nor ashamed before you.
You may stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have filled all the earth with the light of your incarnate word. By your grace, empower us to reflect your light in all that we do, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let me see.
Forward for a children's message. How are you?
Good.
Thanks for coming up. So I have a stack of books here. And what does the front of it say? The Holy Bible. We think of the Bible as one book, right? One big bound book. But it's actually a collection of a lot of little books, right? So this kind of is a nice symbol of the Bible. If you open this up, what would you expect to find in here? Some stories about what? About Jesus and God. What about you? Some words, okay? Braxton, what do you think might be in here? Do you want to open it for us and see? Come on over. I'm just trying to get it right here, buddy. Is that what you expected to find? A little bit of hay material and a picture of the Nativity. Martin Luther, who's the founder of our Lutheran faith, said that the Bible is the cradle wherein Christ is laid. And in just a few minutes, Pastor Ed is going to be reading our gospel lesson today that comes from the Gospel of John and says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So do you think that the Bible was right with God during the creation of the world? Do you think that the Bible was with God at the creation of the world? Do you think the Bible existed then as a bunch of words for us to read? No. But what do you think did exist with God in the beginning? Who could the Word be in that gospel lesson? Here's a hint, he's saying it. Jesus, right? Yeah, and so I think that's really awesome. When you open your actual Bible that has actual words, it's great to be reminded that the actual Word of God that we encounter in the Bible is actually Jesus, and that the Bible is a way in which Jesus can come among us, and just like Jesus did on Christmas when we found him in the manger. Let's pray together. Lord, we give you thanks for your word with a capital W, the word that is Jesus, who dwells among us, that we encounter in the Bible, and that we encounter when we come into community with one another. Remind us, Lord, as we hear your word and open your Bible, that it's Jesus we encounter because of your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Today is a reading from the letter to the Ephesians, chapter 1, verses 3 through 14. Blessed be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time, to gather all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the words of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance towards redemption as God's own people to the praise of his glory. The word of the Lord.
This morning we have the fifth and final video between our lesson, sharing the message of Advent and Christmas.
To the Creator's wishing right, that even
Invite you to stand for the reading of the gospel. Holy Gospel according to St. John, the first chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John testified to him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks ahead of me, because he was before me.' From his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. The law indeed was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known." This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. 253. I counted them. 253 words. That's the count. 253 words. That's the count in the American Bible Society's Greek New Testament, counting the words that John used to begin his gospel that you just heard. This is the New Revised Standard Version, the English translation of those words. And the 253 words in this translation become 304 words. And that's no surprise. John, very particular, very careful in the images and words he uses. And it always seems to take more words to bring it to life when we bring it into English. Well, whether we have the Greek 253 words or the English 304 words, the words are beautiful and majestic. Would you not agree? So majestic are these words that tradition has given John the honorific St. John the Divine. Well deserved. So beautiful and majestic are these words that one of the symbols used to personify John is the eagle that soars into the heavens to reveal the glory and majesty of God, as these words do. It's fitting that the church, the Western church calendar, honor John on a particular day, almost closely connected, to the celebration of Christmas itself, December 27th, second day following the great festival of Christmas. Fitting, that John be given that day, so close to Christmas. The biblical scholars of our world and the commentators of Scripture, folks who are well known for their great and long dissertations, scholarly dissertations, they call this the prologue. The prologue to the Gospel of John. Prologue, interesting word. Prologue my foot, actually. Is that what I read to you just now? A prologue? Is that what you heard on Christmas Eve night? There at the close of worship when the candles were lit, glowing beautifully in the darkness. Prologue? Sounds rather dull. Prologue. No, these words are not a prologue. These words are poetry. The poetry of love. Poetry of God's love. John has written these words because they express the deepest affection of his heart for the God who loves him and calls John beloved. That's how John identifies himself in the latter pages of his gospel. I am the disciple, the beloved, the one whom Jesus loved. Beautiful, beautiful poetry of love John has written here at the beginning of his gospel. I wonder how long it took John, how many years had to pass before he was able to find the right 253 words to speak of that love from his soul. You may remember from tradition that Christian tradition suggests John was the youngest of the disciples, perhaps 15 or 16 years old. And he lived to be the oldest, perhaps 97 or 98 years old when he died. And we know that John was the last of the four Gospels written. Indeed, his book, one of the last of the New Testament books written. So it's safe to say, I believe, that John, well, it took him many years before he found the right words to put on paper to begin his gospel. Some scholars say that John wrote the stories and the conversations that follow this poetry, that he wrote the stories and conversations first, then kind of stepped back. And was moved to write the poetry that begins his gospel. And that may be right. I'm of a mind to think it happened more like this. That John, finally, after many years, found those words, inspiring words, putting them on paper, that beautiful poetry, and then stepping back and taking it in, and then saying, how do I explain it to the people, what these words mean for my heart? How can I find the words to do that, so they will know the same love of Jesus as I have known? And then came the stories and the conversations. I say that because that seems to be how other contemplatives or mystics have experienced it. Some of the great ones like St. John of the Cross, or Julian of Norwich, or Hildegard of Bingen. These are famous in the tradition. They had deep visionary experiences, and sometimes it moved them to put it into poetry, trying to capture what God, how God had touched their soul. And then years would pass before they could finally find the everyday kind of words to explain it to everyone else, that deep experience of God. And I think the same was true for John. That's the challenge. How do you find the words to capture what has happened deep inside your soul because God loves you so much. How do you find the right words? What if I gave you the challenge today? I'm not going to do it. You could do it on your own. But what if I had the ushers hand to you three sheets of white paper? First two in case you make mistakes. Three sheets of white paper, and ask that you place on paper the words from deep within your soul that express how God's love has changed your life. Not just a familiar Bible passage or a Christmas memory or an expression of a doctrine or belief, but words that really express the heartfelt affection of your soul for God. Could you do it? Could you do it in 253 words? Prose or poetry, your choice. Or 304 words, to use the English count. Could you even find the 5 or 7 words for that first sentence? How many pages should I give you? I said 3. Maybe you need a stack of pages, because page after page would be crumpled and say, those aren't the right words. Maybe a whole ream of paper. If you find it challenging, don't feel bad. The first time I tried my hand at trying to understand the words John had written, it didn't go so well. I was overwhelmed. I was kind of a brash young man back in seminary my final year, thinking I could write about this, and had taken a class in John with Professor Robert Smith. He was a lover of the Gospel of John. I had attended many of his lectures over the years in seminary, and he certainly instilled in me a love for this gospel. But I'm taking a class as my seminary journey is ending, just a few of us in the class, and he gave the assignment. We were to write a 20-page dissertation on some topic of John, not counting the pages of footnotes and bibliography, because this was to be a scholarly study. And I chose the prologue, as we called it back then. And I went to work, and I was swallowed up in endless books and essays from the scholars on these verses. And I had all these note cards. We didn't have computers then. Remember those index cards, scribbling notes, trying to organize them to somehow capture the beauty and mystery of what John had written. I'll just say it this way. My dissertation was more a train wreck than truly grasping the beauty of what John had written. I should have told Robert Smith, I should have told him I needed more time. Not just more time to read a few more books and organize the notes, but simply a few more years to live and to live into the mystery of God's great love for me. Same is true for you. A few more years to know what it was like to be in the darkness of this world. John writes of that. Of the darkness and how light was coming into that darkness. And the light shines in the darkness. I needed a few more years to know the darkness and how the light shines in the darkness, and to know the truth, the darkness cannot overcome the light. And when we are drawn to the light, how we become more fully the children of God. Beautiful what John has written. Professor Smith, I simply needed a few more years. And if God is good to us, those years are given. And we begin to, if we are open to it, to fathom the mystery of God's deep love within us. It takes some years. I wonder how many years it was for John. How many years from that teenage day when he heard first the call of Jesus? How many years it took him to begin to find the right words to put it on paper what that call was all about? It says of his call, it came this way. He had a lot of questions for Jesus, and Jesus simply answered, "Well, John, come and see. Why don't you just spend some time with me? Come and see." That's how he writes it in the first chapter. Come and see. What a beautiful invitation for all of us, right? Just Jesus simply saying, "Oh, you have so many questions. Tell you what. Why don't you just come and see? I'll show you who I am. You will learn. You'll learn more fully who you are as well. Come and see." I wonder how many years it took for John to begin to find the right words to describe the deep experience of Christ in the upper room. Oh, a deeply traumatic time, a time of great fear. Already the grief upon them, a darkness encroaching. When John writes of his experience years later, he writes it this way. He says, "In that room, I was leaning on the bosom of Jesus." What a beautiful image. "I was leaning on the bosom of Jesus, and I heard him say that he was not abandoning me or the others, but that he loved us. And he said it, no greater love than this, than to lay down my life for my friends. And tonight, I want you to know you are my friends." I wonder how long it took for John, how many years had to pass before he had the courage and the strength to write of that experience standing at the foot of the cross. Never easy to talk about death and suffering. How many years did it take for him to have the strength to speak of his Savior on the cross, suffering and dying? He was splattered with the blood of Jesus to be washed in that blood. He'll write of that experience years later. He will write in his gospel, also in the first chapter, pointing to Jesus on the cross, John the Baptist saying, "Behold the Lamb of God. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And how many years had to pass before he could find the right words to describe that moment, that first Easter moment, so soon after the death on the cross, when he stood in the grave, the rays of sun that was just coming up over the horizon, piercing that dark tomb, and seeing it empty, and breathing not the stench of death, resurrection life. John would write of that resurrection life, remembering the words of Jesus there at the grave of Lazarus, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me shall not die, but live." It took John many years to write those words. And when he wrote, wow. In the beginning, that's how he starts it. Just like Genesis. In the beginning was the Word. The Word that is God. The Word that reveals the very heart of God to us. A Word that brings the whole of creation to reveal the glory of God to us. Word that is love that holds the whole creation together and continues to give it life. You recall from Genesis, it says we are created in the image of God. Well, that's just the beginning of your story. And John writes, the Word has come into this world to shine and to lead and to show you the rest of the story. How you are to grow into the likeness of God. How you are to grow to the full stature of Christ. How do we do that? John writes it beautifully. He says, well, to show us how to become the likeness of God, the full stature of Christ. Word became flesh,
flesh and blood. Simple as that. The Word became flesh and lived among us. And in this flesh, we see the glory of a Father's only Son, and it is full of grace and truth. It is as God intended it to be. How do you grow into the likeness of God? Well, the song kind of said it. He plants our feet right on the ground. This is where it's at. And God simply asks, become who I have created you to be. Become the flesh and blood I have created you to be, shaped by my hands, filled with my spirit, filled with the presence of Christ. Live it. Become it. And we know it as we see it in Christ, that life of love, freely given. John writes beautiful words. The Word became flesh and lived among us. We've seen his glory. The glory of God is there, and it's full of grace and truth. Struck by how those two words are woven together, grace and truth. Very easy for Christians to get caught up in the truth and never get around to the grace. It's very easy for people in this world to desperately seek truth and never know grace. Now, the great philosophers of the world, Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, from that ancient day to the present day, seeking the truth, but never connecting that truth they seek to the grace that is given. The great scientists of today, Stephen Hawking, Isaac Newton, Albert Einstein, all speak eloquently of searching for the truth that holds and explains the whole universe, but never stumbling upon the deepest force and power of all, that power of God's love. Power of grace that brings the whole world into being. Or Pilate, remember what he said to Jesus in the Gospel of John, truth? What is truth? For sure, Pilate did not know grace. Grace and truth wedded together. Grace and truth, to know the depths of God's love in your heart, and that you are his beloved, man, that's foundational truth. That's the kind of truth that expresses the very beauty of God and the beauty of this creation. The truth of God's grace in your life, to know that you are his beloved. Well, John said it in 253 words, finally. Probably when his eyesight was dim, his legs weak, and his beard pretty wispy and gray. And how beautifully he said it. What words express that truth and that grace in your life? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to stand.
Thank you.
God with us, let us boldly pray for the church, the world, and all in any need. God of wisdom, open our ears to hear your grace through the words and deeds of children. Inspire the youngest and oldest in our midst to learn from one another with humility and patience. Hear us, O God. God of creation, praise to you for hills and mountains, fruit trees and forests, animals wild and tame, sea monsters, birds and reptiles. Spark delight in our hearts for all that you have made. Hear us, O God. God of hope, call us to peace and bind us together in perfect unity. Make wars to cease. Guide the leaders of the nations in your way of wisdom, compassion, and tolerance. Hear us, O God. God of healing, mend the broken hearts of those who suffer this day. Treasure everyone who struggles with addiction, loneliness, hunger, unemployment, mental illness, or sickness. Hear us, O God. God of life, draw us into the body of Christ and make us grow in faith and in hope. Fill us with hearts of thanksgiving made visible in our words and actions for the sake of the whole world. Hear us, O God. God of delight, fill us with songs of praise and hope, even in the midst of despair and death. Comfort the grieving. Strengthen our faith until the day we will be gathered around your throne singing in eternal praise. Hear us, O God. Trusting in the presence of God by the power of the Holy Spirit, we commend all for whom we pray, dwelling in the light and hope of Christ our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share the peace with one another.
Thank you.
few announcements. First, continue to wish all of you a very Merry Christmas, as well as a Happy New Year just around the corner. Want to also express gratitude on behalf of the congregation to Ed Meadle and his mighty team. I bet over 100 volunteers at least for that. If you were a part of that volunteer experience, thank you. Thank you, Ed. Please pass gratitude on to everyone from our congregation, and I think one way to show that is with a good round of applause. About 700 meals, Ed tells me, were served here. Another couple of hundred meals on wheels and many other meals delivered to fire stations, Boys Town, Hope Harbor, and many places. So about 1,100 meals in all. Again, thank you. Some of you know Shirley Wagner of our church. She often worships on Saturday evenings with her daughter. She has struggled with some sickness, and then on Christmas Eve, she passed away. Her funeral will be tomorrow here at this church, 10:30 in the chapel. But again, Shirley Wagner, we entrust her to God. I invite you to stand now. Please join me in the offering prayer. Good and loving God,
we rejoice in the birth of Jesus, who came among the poor to bring the riches of your grace. As you have blessed us with your gifts, let them be blessed for others. With the trees of the field, with all the earth and heaven, we shout for joy at the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We give them to you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. In the wonder and mystery of the Word made flesh, you have opened the eyes of faith to a new and radiant vision of your glory, that beholding the God made visible, we may be drawn to love the God whom we cannot see. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. As Mary and Joseph went from Galilee to Bethlehem and there found no room, so Jesus went from Galilee to Jerusalem and was despised and rejected. As in the poverty of a stable Jesus was born, so by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. As your Word became flesh born of woman in the night long ago, so also in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection, and we look with hope for his coming.
Amen.
Holy God, we long for your spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. All praise and glory are yours, Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, Power of the Most High, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Invite us to join hands as we pray for the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Seated. The mystery for the ages is revealed to us in this meal. Come, behold, and receive your God.
What a Christ shed for you.
The body of Christ given. The blood of Christ shed for you.
The body of Christ given for you.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
Thank you.
Congregation may stand. May this body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that in this bread and cup of Christ's very life, you give us food for our journey, as you led the Magi by a star, as you brought the Holy Family home again, guide us on the way unfolding before us. Wherever we go, may our lives proclaim good news and great joy in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the word that Mary brought to birth carry you into new and abundant life. May the word that Joseph cradled in his arms enfold you with love and strength. May the word that angels proclaimed in song bring harmony to our world. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.